Hey guys, so this is my current workstation PC. I built this ITX rig about a couple years ago. I've been really happy with this machine. It's quiet, it looks really cool, it's tiny. It just chews through my workflow, which is DaVinci Resolve, which is my primary choice for editing videos, Photoshop, Lightroom for my photo edits, and just the general tasks that I do here at the studio. And if I go mobile, this is what I carry with me. The XPS 13 from Dell. It's portable, it fits in my bag, I love the display, the battery life is great, and it does an okay job with editing photos. But the performance just drips drastically when I switch to battery mode. So I've been looking for a happy medium between taking my work with me wherever I go and also getting something that's a little bit more efficient with battery life. Now look, I've been through countless Windows laptops in the past and they're all great. You know, the gaming performance is great. It does a fantastic job with editing videos and stuff. The one thing that I really was looking for is efficiency. And I just wasn't able to find that with any Windows laptop so far. And guess what? I think I might have a solution for that. Folks, this is the new 16-inch MacBook Pro from Apple with the new M1 Pro chip. And I'm gonna switch my entire setup to macOS and share my experience with you over the long term. So this is sort of like my day one unboxing and setting this up. I'm gonna, you know, basically switch my PC to the Mac, transfer all my files, find things that I need to ditch because I know that this new laptop has a lot of ports. So, you know, we'll see what we are working with. And yeah, just take you through my experience switching to Mac. All right, guys, so I'm about to go set up the A-Roll to record my experience using the Razer Pro Type Ultra keyboard and then the Pro Click Mini Mouse. These are some of the new stuff that Razer's coming out to complete their productivity lineup. But either way, I'm gonna be recording and editing this video entirely on the new Mac. So I'm excited for that because I know that Resolve has just updated their software to support the new M1 Pro and M1 Max processors. So it'll be interesting to see what the performance is gonna be like, rendering it, and also just scrubbing through the timeline, adding my color grading, and just doing my usual thing. All right, so that edit turned out to be really successful on the new MacBook Pro. I had no issues with scrubbing through the timeline. Performance felt very similar to, you know, the desktop PC that I had before, which is awesome. An amazing thing that still boggles my mind is this thing is stupid quiet. Like, I was just not able to hear the fans whatsoever. Maybe because I'm just not pushing it enough, but I mean, right now I'm in Resolve scrubbing through 4K footage and I can't even hear a darn thing from this machine. What's even crazy is that it doesn't even get hot. Surface temperatures on this thing is actually really, really low, or at least lower compared to Windows laptops that are running, you know, Resolve at full load. It's just, it still boggles my mind in terms of what the silicon can do. I do want to show you guys exactly what my setup is like, because obviously switching from a desktop PC to a Mac, especially a laptop, does bring some compromises in terms of the port situation and just a few things. But interestingly, I haven't actually made any compromises. So let me show you what I'm working with. What you're seeing here is the notebook docked in a vertical position. I picked up this dock from Amazon. It's actually really high quality aluminum stand. I'll make sure to leave a link down below if you're interested. But I like this vertical position simply because it kind of keeps things clean. And I'm powering this entire setup, including my monitor, my keyboard, my external hard drive, and my audio interface using this Razer Thunderbolt 4 dock. It's got chroma lighting. Unfortunately, I can't disable it because Synapse is not available for macOS, but that's something that I have to live with. But check this out. This entire thing is powered by a single USB-C Thunderbolt 4 cable. That's just amazing. What's even cool is I've got three SD card readers in this whole setup. So I've got one with the laptop, which is awesome, one that comes with the dock, and then another one with the monitor. I mean, I can't ever complain about SD card readers in my life. So that's great.
All right, so it's been a little over 2 months since switching to the new MacBook Pro, and I've successfully edited and rendered 13 videos in that time frame, including this one that you're watching at the moment. Now, the biggest transition for me was learning to use macOS, because the layout is completely different from Windows. Not to mention the keyboard shortcuts, because a lot of them use Command instead of Control, so I had to sort of train my muscle memory to get used to that workflow. I'm actually obsessed with the Command-Shift-5 shortcut. It's basically a screenshot and screen recording tool that I use a lot for video production, and it works really, really well. I had to reformat all of my external drives from NTFS to macOS Extended Journal, since I wasn't able to write any data onto the drives. But other than that, I'm actually pretty comfortable getting used to this operating system. I've also been enjoying AirDrop with my iPhone for quick file sharing, and the fact that I can take phone calls and send text messages from my computer. Heck, even recently I just discovered that I could use my iPad Air as a secondary display. It's a feature called Sidecar, and I've been integrating that into my editing workflow. It's just really refreshing to see the continuity between these devices. It's an ecosystem, and it just works.
Play your games the right way with the much improved Virtuoso RGB Wireless XT with Bluetooth support, fantastic swivel hinges, deeper ear cushions, tactile controls with USB-C charging, a beefy microphone to step up your comms game, and awesome wireless sound reproduction. Check it out below.
Now, from a hardware standpoint, the MacBook Pro is incredible. The aluminum construction feels sturdy, and it's by far one of the best built laptops that I've come across. It's also very thin, coming in at 0.66 inches or 16.7 millimeters, and it weighs less than 5 pounds. So I had to compromise a little bit in terms of portability compared to my XPS 13, and I had to ditch my tiny messenger bag for an actual backpack to accommodate the MacBook Pro, but I saw that coming. Now, I could have switched to the 14-inch MacBook Pro if I was really picky about portability, but I was really curious to experience the 16-inch model since it comes with a larger display. And I'm really happy with that choice because it's absolutely beautiful. Now, it's not OLED, but the mini LED technology produces some amazing results. I recently had the opportunity to shoot a wedding, and I edited all of my photos using this display while sitting at a Starbucks shop. And it did a fantastic job at handling that. The larger screen real estate really, really helps with my workflow. It's also bright and comes with ProMotion, which adapts up to 120 hertz for a smooth experience. Now, initially, there were some issues with certain apps supporting that feature, particularly Safari, but the latest update to macOS 12.2 addressed that. Another drawback of this panel is if you have a pitch black screen with some content on it, specifically texts, you'll notice a blooming effect. Now, this is an artifact caused by one dimming zone affecting neighboring zones. It's not terrible, and 99% of the time, I'll always have something else on it other than just a black screen, but it's something to take into account. Now, about that notch at the top. Honestly, it has grown on me, and since I have it docked at my workstation throughout the day, it doesn't really bother me that much since I use it with an external monitor. It would have been cool if Apple made it smaller or somewhat seamless with the rest of the panel, but hey, I mean, look at what they did with the iPhones. Everybody hated the notch at the beginning, but now it's a design staple for Apple. The keyboard is fantastic with good amount of travel distance and feedback. TouchID is ridiculously fast. I love how I can use it to make payments and log into the laptop. The trackpad is so good and responsive that I actually enjoy editing videos on it while I'm outside the office. Now, usually if I'm on a Windows laptop, I would bring an external mouse with me, but the integration with the OS and third-party apps, it just works so well, guys. The speakers also blew my mind. The output is just so powerful and boomy with great fidelity in the high ends. It just literally puts every other Windows laptop on the market to shame. And that's coming from someone who has reviewed a ton, and I mean a ton, of Windows laptops in the past.
The same goes for the webcam. The dynamic range is really good, and I like the way how the 1080p sensor treats my skin tones. The microphone quality is also superb. And honestly, if I were to compare this to my XPS 13, there's just no competition because both the webcam quality and the microphone quality is pretty terrible.
The port situation is pretty good on the new MacBook Pro. Apple did bring back the full-size SD card reader, which I'm sure everyone appreciates. It's UHS 2, so transferring footage from my Canon EOS R and my Fuji X-T3 was pretty fast. The HDMI port on this laptop is 2.0 and not 2.1, so it only caps your output to 4K at 60 hertz, and that's certainly a downside. On the other hand, MagSafe charging is the most convenient way to charge this laptop. It just snaps onto the laptop and it's pretty strong, and there's an LED indicator that shows the status. I absolutely love it. Now, I'm not gonna go too deep into performance because I've done a separate video comparing it to a pro Windows laptop, and the results just completely blew my mind. You should actually certainly check that out if you've missed it. But in a nutshell, this thing just flies through my everyday productivity tasks. The fact that I'm getting a similar experience, if not better, compared to my custom-built 2080 Ti PC is truly remarkable. And on top of that, it manages to maintain that performance while being on battery. So the efficiency factor is a huge bonus with the new M1 Pro chip. Speaking of battery life, it's excellent. I mean, I've gone into 3 days without plugging it in, and that's something that I've never been able to achieve, even with my XPS 13, so that certainly says something. Actually, I have a special guest who's also been using the MacBook Pro as his main computer, so let's pay him a visit and see what he has to say. Let's go.
What's up? Oh, we're already starting. All right.
Yeah, we're already starting.
So guys, this is Matt's studio. It looks amazing. Matt, what exactly do you do?
I make videos on the internet. Not that kind of videos. Tech videos.
So you've been using the MacBook Pro 16-inch for...
I'd say since it came out. Like, what, it's a couple months now?
What made you switch to the new MacBook Pro?
Honestly, it sounds so small, but it's no fan noise. Like, right now you can hear my PC going brr. This is like the Beast Canyon NUC from Intel with an RTX 3080, and I use that for some stuff like gaming, but this never goes on. Like, the fans are always quiet, and the performance is so good now that I don't feel like I'm sacrificing using a Mac over a PC anymore, which is absolutely crazy. I didn't think I'd ever get to this spot.
So does the new MacBook Pro actually complement with your desk setup?
Yeah, it does. So like, there are so many reasons why I leave it open like this. Just being able to use it as a webcam, the speakers, the microphone, and just having that all in one device instead of just buying like a separate webcam and then separate speakers that take up your entire desk. This is just everything in one. So even when I'm done like using this as a desk setup, I can just unplug the one cable and then take it home with me.
Now, have you experienced any issues with the new MacBook Pro?
So from a hardware standpoint, no, there hasn't been any like hardware issues unless you consider a notch a problem, right? But most of the issues have been software based. Because we're using Apple Silicon, all the software that we use today hasn't caught up yet. So even when I was first using DaVinci Resolve, when I got the Mac, there were a lot of little glitches. It would pause, it would sometimes crash, but ever since the last couple of updates, it's been absolutely solid. So just little things like that.
Now, would you ever consider a ideal Windows laptop replacement for that MacBook Pro?
Look, I'm not one of those guys that like sticks to one camp. I'm open to both platforms. It's whatever does the better job for me. And as of today, this seems to be doing the better job just because of the portability and quietness that it offers. But yeah, of course, I'd totally be open to switching back to Windows laptops if it's just as quiet as efficient as this.
So there you have it. The new MacBook Pro is amazing, and I'm gonna continue to use it every single day here at the office. Now, there are a few reasons to avoid this laptop. The first and most obvious is the price. Don't get me wrong, this thing is really expensive. However, if I examine my situation, this machine fills that void between my desktop PC and the XPS 13. And if you're on the same boat as I am, except for gaming, this should be on the top of your list. Secondly, the lack of user upgradable options is a big deal for a lot of people. I have the model with 32 gigabytes of RAM, and if I want to upgrade to 64 gigabytes, well, I can't because everything is soldered onto the PCB, including the SSD. So yes, there are compromises, but it ultimately depends on how you look at those compromises and how those compromises affect your workflow 5 or 6 years down the line. So that's my story with the new MacBook Pro. I hope you guys enjoyed this one, and let us know if you guys are excited about the future of ARM computing. I mean, I know that Intel's 12th gen Alder Lake CPUs are here, AMD's Ryzen 6000 series are here. We're gonna bring in a lot of comparisons later on, but yeah, it's good to see competition, you know? That's what 2022 is, or at least every year, that's what it's all about. So stay tuned for more cool content, and I'll talk to you guys in the next one.